At this stage, we are aware of what all loading cases need to be considered in the flexibility analysis. We know how to obtain the allowable stresses. And we also have seen the check to see whether the piping flexibility analysis is required or not required. Now, having established that piping needs flexibility analysis, like the problem that we have seen, you need to do the actual piping flexibility analysis. The performance of the piping flexibility analysis would require software. There are some free softwares also available using which we could have done that, but this particular calculation is outside the course. So we will have a look at some of the salient points which are involved in the piping flexibility calculation, that is actual use of the software. We will just have briefly look at these, mainly in terms of how the stress check is done. So that needs to be understood. So if you are reading the piping flexibility analysis generated by software, then you should be knowing what all things you should be looking at. So that is what we will see next. First, we'll have a look at some of the commonly used or the software which are used by the industry for doing the piping flexibility analysis. So there are three software. One is the Caesar 2, which is quite old and popular software for doing the piping flexibility analysis. Not only flexibility analysis, but all sort of piping calculations. So it is available. The second is AutoPipe, which is by Bentley. And the third is CIE Pipe. So I have given the website address. So if you are interested, you can have a look at that. For CIE Pipe, the last option, which was earlier available as a for non-academic purpose, they are having a full version available. So that is known as, also known as, previously it was known as K-Pipe, which was very popular software at that time. So now it is coming under a different name. So these are the softwares using which you can conduct the actual piping flexibility analysis. And you can get more details by visiting their website and see some demo of this software. Next, we will see into the some of the important factors that essentially the different stress checks that are done in the through this piping flexibility analysis, and some of the important terms which are required to be understood when you are doing piping flexibility analysis. So first we'll look at the two terms which are important for doing flexibility analysis. The first term is known as flexibility factor K. So what this factor means is, typically in the piping you have different types of fittings. So you have elbows. So let's take an example of elbow, which is easier to understand. So if you consider an elbow in a pipeline and take a straight pipe which is having same length as that of the developed length of the elbow. So this L of this pipeline, so both straight pipe and elbow are of the same diameter and the developed length is same. What this flexibility factor K is defined as, it's a ratio of flexibility, that is deformation per unit load of the component, so the component in this case is elbow, to that of straight pipe having same length and cross section. So if you have an elbow, its flexibility factor would be given as the ratio of deformation per unit load of this elbow. So if you are applying, let's say, force F onto this elbow in X direction, so there is a force F acting on this elbow, it will deform by certain amount. So there will be some delta 1 for this elbow. The same force, if you apply on the straight pipeline, you will get another value of the deformation. So this flexibility factor is defined as delta 1 by delta 2. So this K need not be in terms of force. The deformation could be in terms of the moment as well. So if you have the moment M, then the elbow will have certain rotation theta 1, and under the same moment M, the other factor will have rotation delta 2. So in that case, the k would be defined as the rotation of the elbow versus rotation of the straight pipe. In general, the elbow, specifically the elbow, will have more flexibility than that of a straight pipeline in bending. It will be more flexible, and that will be useful parameter to be considered in the flexibility analysis. So when you are doing the flexibility analysis, essentially you are joining the elements as structural members which are joined at the corner. So at this corner, if elbow is there, the flexibility of this corner, so this is the corner, without considering the additional flexibility, this joint would be stiff. So what the flexibility analysis software does is it uses this flexibility factor k and introduces additional flexibility at this particular corner. So for every piping element that exists, and flexibility factor is applied, and then the piping flexibility analysis is done. So since the piping structure is an indeterminate structure, the stiffness of the various members influence the values of reactions and stresses. So by introducing the flexibility factor, in the model, the sharp corners which are there, for example, where the elbows will be fitting, they would be made more flexible in terms of this flexibility factor k. The other factor that needs to be taken into account, or which is considered, is known as stress intensification factor, or it is also shortened as SIF. And denoted by a letter small I. So this is also a ratio. So this stress intensity factor is defined as ratio of actual bending stress in a component to that of theoretical value of bending stress when moment is applied at the nominal cross section. So if you again take an example of an elbow and you apply a bending moment to this particular elbow, you will get the theoretical bending stress in this particular elbow, which you will calculate as m divided by section modulus of this elbow. But because of the geometry, that is a three-dimensional geometry with curvature, the actual bending stress in this elbow would be different. So if this is theoretical stress, so this is sigma t, and actual stress I'm calling as sigma a, this factor I is defined as sigma a, that is the actual bending stress, divided by the theoretical bending stress. So let me put th, and this is actual, just to avoid confusion in terms of the nomenclature. So it is ratio of actual to theoretical stress. So again, this is used to correct the stress values which are obtained from the analysis to the actual values. It is also used in the acceptability of the stresses, which we are going to see next. So there, this factor k and I are useful. The k is essentially used in the flexibility analysis itself. In the model, piping model, the k value is included, and I factor is included in the final evaluation. So once you obtain the stresses, whether they are safe or not safe is done by using the stress intensity factor. Now, for the purpose of calculations, one need to know the values of k and I. So they are available in the form of a table from the design code. So let's have a look at. So what we are looking table. On the screen is the table which gives you the value of stress intensity factor and flexibility factor. So this is taken from ASME B31.1. In 31.3, again, similar table is there. So what this particular table gives you is first column is the component. So as you can see here, so there are different components. So description of the component and sketch of the component are given. So for example, if you take an elbow or a pipe bend of the given geometry, so the geometry is defined in terms of radius of elbow, the bend radius of elbow, the main pipe radius of the elbow, and the thickness of the elbow, then the various factors are defined. So we are interested in the flexibility factor and the stress intensification factor, so K and I factors, they are defined in terms of the characteristic parameter H for that component. So for every component, the H is defined. So in terms of the geometry of that component, the H is defined. And in terms of this H, the values of K, so this is the K or the flexibility factor and stress intensification factor are defined by this particular formula. So in this particular fashion, in this particular table, the various components, like the next is miter bend, then you have T with reinforcement and so on. So the different type of elements, you will get the intensity, the K factor and I factor from this particular table. In the piping flexibility analysis software, these tables are already inbuilt. So once you specify the component, these factors are directly picked by the software. If you are doing manual calculation, then you have to refer to this code table and pick the values for doing the calculations. So we have seen that in order to evaluate or perform the flexibility analysis, there are two important terms which one should know. One is the flexibility factor K and the second is stress intensity factor I. Both of these are available in the design code for various components which come in the piping system. And finally, we look at the checks which are done for each of the three cases. So we have seen in the beginning, there are three cases which needs evaluation. The first case is a sustained load case, and the second is the displacement control load case or the thermal expansion case. And the last one is the occasional load case. So for each of the load case, once we have done the flexibility analysis, we'll obtain the stresses and internal reactions at various points. So using that, you can calculate at every point of the piping whether it is acceptable or not acceptable. So typically, flexibility analysis, for example, if this is your piping, so the piping will consist of various nodes. So you will have, for example, node 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So at each of the node, the checks which we are going to see now will be performed. So at each of the nodes, so for example, if at this particular elbow 2, we will calculate what are the internal reactions and the stresses there, and we'll perform the checks which are given there. So for the sustained load case, the check which needs to be done is in terms of the longitudinal stress due to sustained loads. So note that in the flexibility analysis, we concentrate on the longitudinal stresses because the bending effects are inducing the longitudinal stresses. The aspect of the hoop stress is taken care by the piping thickness formula that we have studied in the first session for piping engineering. So because of internal pressure, the hoop stresses which get generated, these are taken into account by the pressure thickness formula, which is based on hoop stress. In the flexibility analysis, we are taking into account the various bending moments, mainly the bending stresses that get induced at various locations of the piping because of their geometry. So they are the longitudinal stresses. So here, if you note, so what we are checking is calculating the longitudinal stress in the pipeline and comparing them with respect to allowable. So the left hand side is the longitudinal stress. So what you see here is the longitudinal stress. So this is the longitudinal stress and we are comparing against the allowable stress. So longitudinal stress consists of two parts. One is the longitudinal stress because of the internal pressure, which will be given by PD by 4T. So that is the first part. And the second part is the bending stress. So bending stress would be given by the net moment at that particular point. So we are talking about this point number 2. So at this point, what is the value of moment? So this moment would be in x, y, z direction. So if at point 2, the moment in x, y direction is mx, my, and mz, the ma will be calculated as the vector resultant of these three values. So this will be the value of ma, which will be used in this calculation. So the resultant moment at that particular point divided by section modulus will give us the value of the theoretical bending stress at that particular value. If you multiply it by I, that is the stress intensification factor, you will get the actual bending stress in that particular component. If you note here, this term in the parenthesis, so we have this 0.75i, and if you look at the note which is given with respect to I, so I is the stress intensity factor, and it says that the product 0.75i should not be taken less than 1. So the I value, that is a stress intensity factor, will be more than 1. However, it is considered, its full effect is considered only in the case of the cyclic loading effect, that is the next load case where what we are considering. In this case, this factor is reduced. So what the factor I indicates is the peak stress value in a component. So for a elbow, at a particular value, you will get the theoretical stress M by Z multiplied by I will be the peak stress at this particular value. Now, these peak stress values are required only in the fatigue analysis. In the regular or the sustained load analysis, we don't require the peak stress values. That is why they are discounted or reduced by 70.7 by multiplying them by 0.75. However, by this reduction, we don't want them to reduce below the theoretical stress, that is M by Z. So that is what is meaning of this product 0.75 should not be less than 1. So this term can never become less than M by Z, which is the theoretical bending stress. And the peak stress value is used to a reduced, to its 25% reduced value for the sustained load case. And the right hand side, SH, we have already seen. So that is a basic allowable stress at the operating temperature. So at the operating temperature, what is the basic allowable stress in terms of the yield strength, UTS, and the creep values? So that this is a material based property, and the left hand side is your piping layout based value. So that is the first check that need to be done. The second check that needs to be done is for the thermal expansion stress range or the displacement stress range. So in this case, the left hand side is the thermal expansion range. So it is again given in terms of MC. So is MC is the vector resultant. So it is again MX square plus MY square plus MZ square under root, where all these three values are corresponding to the thermal loading. And since here we are talking about stress range, so these are the moment ranges. So this is range of moment which are considered in this particular case. And Z has the usual meaning, and SA is the allowable stress range. So SA in terms of 1. If you remember, it is F multiplied by 1.25 SC plus 0.25 SH. So that is the allowable stress which is considered on the right hand side. So here we are comparing only because of the temperature effect, whatever stresses are induced. The theoretical stress is amplified here by the full stress intensification factor. So the full peak stress effect is taken into account in this formula. So you note that there is no 0.75 in this case, in this particular case, which was there in the sustained load case. So that is point to be noted in this particular calculation. So we have done the two checks, the sustained load check, the displacement load check, or the thermal stress load check. The last check is corresponding to the occasional loading. So in the case of occasional loading, the left hand side consists of first the longitudinal stress because of pressure. The second is the longitudinal stress because of the sustained loads. So this corresponds to the sustained loads. And the last term is the stress term, which is because of the occasional loads. So this is corresponding to the occasional load terms. So again, under the occasional load, that is, if there is a wind load, then under wind load, what are the internal reactions, internal moments which are getting generated? Those will be calculated, and the stress because of them will be included. So here again, the peak or the full value of stress intensification factor is not taken, but it is discounted by 25%. And on the right hand side, you are having the allowable stress, which is increased by a factor k. So this k factor depends on the nature of loading. So what you mean by nature of loading is for how long, how much duration that effect would be there. So if you are considering seismic effect, in the lifetime of equipment, how many earthquake you are expecting, and what is the duration of that? So that will be geographic data which will be available for the seismic design code. So this K factor is typically between 1.5 to 1.2. So we are considering about 15 to 20% higher allowable stress in the case of occasional loads. So that is the way three checks would be done corresponding to the three load cases. So in summary, that is how the report of a piping flexibility analysis would look like. So it will have initially the piping layout and the material properties as the input. Based on that, it will perform the analysis, calculate the internal forces and moments at every point, and based on that, it will calculate the for each load case what are the values of the stresses, and the checks which are given here, the last three slides that we have seen, those checks will be done and the result will be available to you. So at every part of your pipeline, every element, all the three check values, they will be given. How much is the margin between the allowable, that is the left hand side and the right hand side, will be available to you in terms of the ratios. And that is how the report would be interpreted. So to summarize, in this particular session, we have seen the essentials of piping flexibility analysis. So this is the main documentation related to the design calculations for a piping, apart from the pressure part calculation. So this particular part is related to the stress analysis of the piping and calculation of the support reactions, and also the vessel connection, that is the nozzle load calculations. There is another part of the flexibility analysis which is related to the dynamic response of the pipeline, which we have not covered at all, but that is also another aspect. The piping analysis is done for three cases, that is what we have seen, and the three cases are the sustained load case, the thermal expansion case, and the occasional loading, which is wind and seismic loading. For each of these load case, there are different allowable stresses. Allowable stresses are defined differently for sustained loads and that for the thermal expansion cases. And there are two factors that we have seen which play important role in the flexibility analysis. That is the flexibility factor K and the stress intensification factor I, that need to be considered in the calculation. And the piping flexibility report will finally give you the margin that is available at every node of your piping layout in terms of what is allowed by the code and what is the actual case. So this is the final session of this course, and we'll conclude the course with this session. I believe that you have gained from this sessions, and the information is beneficial to your learning. As usual, if you have any questions, you are welcome to contact me. Thank you for your patience and time in going through this course. I wish you all the best. Thank you and goodbye.